Trying to make your heart feel like a glow. What in me is it wrong? Thank you.
And whatever happened, Tuesday and so slow. Gone down the old man with a transistor radio. Standing in the sunlight laughing. Hiding behind a rainbow's wall. Slipping in the sun. All along the waterfall with you. Brown eyed girl.
Something good has been done. Strange song and daughter. Out of the peace train. Live over YouTube to the world right now. So watch what you say. Not everything you do in this room stays in Roslyn, Virginia. So We have a very special program tonight. Before I get on to that, let me just tell you about CAD Microsystems and how we support the design, construction, owner community that uses technology. One of the ways we do this is through our user groups. CAD Microsystems runs 40 user groups in 4 cities up and down the Mid-Atlantic, as you see here. So if you know of anybody in any other cities that likes what you see here at this user group, we're doing very similar things in Raleigh, Baltimore, in Richmond too as well. And for those of you who are watching online, if you can make it to any one of these user groups, it's a really great place to connect with people that are like-minded with your technology. So please be aware of that. And the whole idea of these user groups is really to get together people and bring together ideas so we kind of self-support each other, in the building information modeling community. So this user group is run by a board of advisors, as is all the other user groups that we have. We have a board of advisors. These are the experts that tell us what's relevant and make sure that these meetings are impactful for you and so that you walk away with something of value. So this board of advisors, Revit DC meeting, and we week after each meeting, and we decide what it is we're going to do at the next meeting. And it all comes from surveys that we send out, which I think is my next slide, if that works. It's not advancing, Donnie, but that's okay. So it's all driven by surveys. It's all driven by what you want to see. So you'll get a survey after this meeting, so please fill out that survey. This really gives us ideas on what is relevant in your world and what you'd like to see at these user group meetings. All right, and tonight's agenda, for what you all came here for, we certainly have a real special presenter tonight. Marcello, he currently serves as the Building Information Modeling Director at John A. Martin Associates Instructional Engineering in Los Angeles, of which he boarded a plane, I'll have you know, 1 o'clock this morning to be here today to present to you. Marcelli's worked on many BIM projects over the last 18 years, including the Walt Disney World Concert Hall in Los Angeles, the Ray and Maria States Center at Massachusetts Institute of Technology, and the Tom Bradley International Airport expansion at Los Angeles International. By the way, is Marcello in the room? There he is. Okay. I wanted to make sure I wasn't going to introduce him. This guy wasn't going to come. Okay, he's here. He's here. He's a professional. And I'm going to pronounce his last name. I don't know, many of you probably have done this. Sgambelluri is internationally recognized as one of the top BIM leaders and contributors to the education and implementation of BIM technology industry. He continually speaks at Autodesk University and Revit Technology Conference, which is now the BiLT Conference. He's received a record total of 14 first place speaker awards. I'll have you know, I don't think anybody is even close to that, maybe 2 or 3 at both conferences. Marcello has received a bachelor's and a master's degree in civil engineering, and he's a licensed civil and a structural engineer. Marcello also has been building a media empire that includes the following, which you should all check out. And really, he named this because this is what I've seen Marcello speak before, and what his talent really is taking complex things and making them simple. So his blogs are Simply Complex blog site, Simply Complex YouTube site, Simply Complex podcast, and the AEC, podcast. So what he's doing tonight is he's taking these 21 presentations and distill them down into one that you're going to see tonight. And for those of you that were wondering how to model a cow in Revit, you're going to find out tonight. Here are his sites. Number one, BiLT presenter for multiple years, 14, consistently voted number one in all. I want you all to have a big round of applause for Marcello Sgambelluri tonight for coming out presenting to Revit DC.
I can just keep going. I'm gonna get this up.
There we go.
Test, test.
Woo! Hello, hello.
How's everyone doing? Okay. I rarely do user groups, so I'm excited that I was invited here to do this. I mostly kind of hit the big stage on this university and built. How many people have seen me speak before? And that includes watching like YouTube or 81 online. Okay, so a few of you. All right, well, I get really animated and I actually love this stuff. Like I said, I've been doing this since 2012. Let me just switch it on over. So just like they said, this is going to be a best of. And if anyone has any questions, just shout them out. This is going to be really informal. Okay, here we go. Here we go. All right. Yeah, so we went over this. So over the last 7 years, I taught 21 Revit classes. I actually taught 37. So someone repeats. So I said, okay, let's do this, Marcello. When you come here, why don't you take your 21 and do the best of. So I decided to pick a topic from each of the classes. And does everyone get a handout? That's what you see here. So I'm going to kind of jump around on the handout. But it's basically my format, one page, how to do something big. Want to model a Revit cap? It's one page. Boom, there you go. All right? So I'm going to get a little bit of everyone. We're going to touch a little bit of Dynamo, a little bit of Revit. I want everyone to open up their eyes because some of this stuff can get kind of crazy, but I will boil it down to something really simple. Okay, I got till 8 o'clock. All right, let's see how far we get. Whew, never done this many topics before. All right, so as you can see, these are some of the models that I've done in the past. Up there on the top right, that's the Revit. I did that back in 2009. That's kind of what started off, actually. I modeled that in Revit, and I said, you know what? I just kept it to myself to see how far I could push the limit. Well, someone from Autodesk saw that and brought it to the factory. And at that time, they were still kind of developing the wall tools. And so they had this saying around the office in Boston. Whenever they tried to do something, they'd say, well, you can model an elephant in Revit, so we can do this. So it helped encourage it and move forward. But if you Google the Revit elephant, I don't know what happened, but everyone's divided on it. It's like half the people love it, and the other half are like, why the hell did you model an elephant? And that's exactly what you like, want to push those limits. You want to have those conversations, right? Should you model in Revit? Maybe. Could you model in Revit? Absolutely. Right? So that's what we're doing. So here's some other things. There's a 747. We're actually going to be able to open that, as well as when I was around downtown. I actually saw an elephant at the Natural History Museum this morning. Kind of nice too. So, and then we've got the cow. There's a red pump down there. There's a piece of mechanical on the bottom right. So we're gonna have a lot of fun. I got a timer up here, and let's get going. All right, you have any questions? Shout them out. So, one more thing. I kind of started
with the media empire. It started with blog site,
I encourage everyone to kind of check it out. And then most recently, I started an AC complex comic. You saw some of the ones that I laid out there. Okay. All right. So let's get going. Whew. So 21 classes. I'm going to kind of go out of order, but I am going to kind of roughly go from the latest to from the oldest to the youngest. All right. All right. Can everyone see that? This is Ride the Rails class, AU 2015, first place. This is using a Ride the Rail method to do rotations. How many people love to do rotation, family building in Revit? Everyone loves it? Okay, let's get rocking and rolling. Let me check my time. It's 6:30 now. Did we start early?
Nice.
Love it. All right, so there's going to be a lot of live demos and a lot of me running around. All right, so just find the page there if you're following along. And if you don't have this handout, you can come get it later. Also, there's a data set for everybody. Talk to the group here. They'll figure out how to get you. Everything I'm doing here, you'll have access. Okay. Whew, let's do it. All right, so let's rock and roll. Here we go. Okay, so Ride the Rail. Why do we call it Ride the Rail? Because it has to deal with rotation. Does anyone have any experience amassing or adaptive component environment in Revit? Go ahead, you're gonna We're gonna get to know each other. Don't be shy. You can't do this. Okay. I don't know what that means. Get up there. All right. Okay. Good. And if you haven't, don't worry. If you're new to Revit, if you're new to Dynamo, don't worry. We'll walk you through it. Okay. We'll start from the very beginning. But basically, what we're gonna do is I'm gonna show everyone how to do this. I'm gonna show everybody how to model this in Revit. Okay, this is kind of a stop in, but this is a. I actually built this for an architect to put it on site, see if this is blazing. But this basically uses the concept of inverse kinematics, and that is a Revit model.
Oh,
we crashed. What happened?
There we go. Okay.
I see you here, but not there. Why is that?
I see you as well, but let's see.
All right, so I might have to do an interpretive. Oh, thank goodness. I was going to do an interpretive dance. Okay, you saw it, right? Okay, that uses the concept of inverse kinematics. Inverse kinematics adds a fancy word. It just means multiple rotations. Okay, so whether you have a single door swing, or bifolding doors, or equipment. That's the concept. Right? I'll show you how to build a rotation rig to rotate one thing, and then you can stack it to rotate many things. Want to see how to do it? Okay, let's see if we can do it in 4 minutes. Ready? Here we go. Okay, I'm going to close that. That video is not happy with that. Okay, here we go. So if you ever want to build any, well, let me back up because I'm getting really excited. It's been a while. This is, believe me, I lived each one of these. So. I get really passionate about it. Okay, what would you do currently to do your rotation rigs? Would you make like two reference lines and then one like this? If you don't build families, don't worry. And then what would you do? You'd put an angle parameter between here, right? And then you would put all your stuff on this. I'm going to say stuff, yeah? Is that what you'd roughly do? Okay, does everyone like when this goes to 90 and 180? Why not? That breaks everything. Autodesk is getting better about it, making it more stable. But I'm here to show you alternate methods. I'm not telling you to do something different in your office, okay? I'm just saying you'll have more skills when you have in your back pocket. If you'd like to use them, please. But believe me, I've been in talks where they're like, Marcello, you told me to use that new method, and I'm not telling you that. I'm going to show you this. You think about it. You're professionals. You make the judgment, okay? But here we go. Now, this is what I was thinking about. This is the masking and adaptive run. I thought, you know what? Why are we controlling rotation with angle parameters? It doesn't make a lot of sense to me. You know what makes a lot of sense to me is actually if we put a point down, and then you can actually host things on points. You just kind of tab this so you get that, and then you put a circle on here. Okay, fair enough. What if you put another point on here? What if you did that? What if you actually connected these two and made a little line between them? What if you actually grabbed this and changed this parameter from normalizing a curve to an angle, and then you actually made that a parameter? Is that breaking at 090 and 180? So that's the concept, okay? You take that thing right here, reference line, and then you can put whatever you want on it. I'm going to call it stuff, okay? So what I'm going to do is I'm not going to show you how to put the stuff on, like in this case with all the hydraulics and stuff. I'm just going to say put stuff on there. But mostly what's important is the bones, yes? Okay, want to do it? So I used to use the word ridiculously simple, but people have gotten over after me with that. So you decide if it's simple or not, okay? I'm not going to say, isn't that ridiculously simple? Okay, so believe me, as you hit social media, believe me, you get a lot of comments. All right, so here we go. So here's the first point. Oh, by the way, I didn't say this. I'm jumping ahead. Get yourself a piece of cut sheet from the internet, or go to the company. In this case, the Hinowa Lift. They were happy to give us these images. You put them, kind of line in elevation and plan. Okay. And then basically, let's just build the rig. Okay, ready? So build a point right there. Why there? And I just kind of started there. But it should be about your center. And then put the first circle on there, roll this thing out. The radius should be about where the first or second rotation point is. Do you see that's a hole? Now I'm not
excuse me, I'm not going to be exact, just someone to proof of concept, right? But this would be to the first linkage, would be about there. Okay, you want to scoop that in a little bit because you're, you know, you want to go ahead. Then you put a point on there. Okay. Then you can connect like that. I do spline through. I pick 2 points and do spline through points. Okay. Anyone ever thought about that? When I want to do a straight line, I pick 2 points and do spline through points. Okay. I do it. That's how I do it all the time. Okay. Yes. Why spline through points? Through 2 points, the spline will become a straight line. If you have 2 points and you've got, and you're building a cowl or a concrete facade, and you've got 5,000 points between you and 5,000 points in front of you, and you want to draw a line between that point and that point, you use your line tool and you try to click that point, and you try to click that point, you're probably not going to get it. So to guarantee 100% of the time that those 2 points are connected between that line, you pick that point, you pick the other point you want, you verify you have them, and then spline 2 points and you got it. Those points will always be posting. That's why. Spline 2 points. Okay. All right. So here we go. I'm going to move on. Okay. Here what we do is we go ahead and we're going to place the second circle on that last point we put, and we just put it on the reference. Okay. And if you're not familiar with the mapping environment, that's okay. We'll kind of break it down. We'll do two of these. And then we'll kind of see what's going on. Take the point, host it to the circle, right about where that, okay? I'm going to build the second linkage, if you call it that, okay? Now I'm going to kind of kick over to 3D, and then you can kind of see what's already going to start to happen here, is if I move this point, then that other point better move with it. You see that? Okay? So did I nest anything? Did I go out, build another family, nest it in? No. Okay, so this is just the power of hosting. Maybe it's not quite apparent yet, but let's keep rocking and rolling. Okay, so what do I do? Set, put it right on that point, we'll build a few more, and then we'll move this thing like in the video. Okay, ready to go like this, boom, here we go. Right there, I'm gonna go to the next one. Right there, I'm gonna keep talking and moving. Put the point right there and host it. Okay, I'm gonna pick these 2 points. I'm gonna do spline 2 points. I'm actually there's not much room for me to mount there, but that's okay. Why that is. Okay, then we're going to set one more. Okay, where do I set this? This next circle, center circle? On a point, yes. I tab to get sure I got that one that's facing me. Okay, and then I put the circle on right there. There. Good, I grabbed the point. I put it there. I'm going to end it there. I'm going to end it there because it could, you know, you can keep going, but you just understand there and there. And I'm going to say, boom. Okay, now I'm going to roll back to 3D. I'm going to see if this thing is working. You always want to test your rigs. All right, so I'm just going to move this one, and everything should move. There we go. See that? Okay, I'm going to do this again. Now, I'm not going to build all that fancy hydraulics. Okay, what I'm going to do is I'm just going to put a point on here, right there, say, and I'm just going to build a little cylinder. Okay, that way we can just kind of do this thing. You know what? There we go. Okay, set. There, circle. There, I'm gonna grow a little bit. I'm gonna grab this. I'm gonna grab these lines I just built. I'm gonna change it to a reference line. I'm gonna then grab this, and I'm gonna say this, just so you know, it's basic. Okay, you're with me. Okay, then I'm gonna go back here and watch how ridiculously simple this. Oh gosh, they said it. Oh boy, I'm gonna put it into this next position, right about there. Right about there, right about there. You got it? Simple, right? Okay, I'm going to do one more right about there. Uh-oh. Well, look, that's a little bit longer. So what? Right? We built these radii. If you want something to telescope, just grab it and pull it like that. How cool is that? Yeah? Simple, right? Okay. Love it. Okay, I'm gonna rock back. I'm gonna show another thing. Is okay, so basically that's it now. Watch this. You think that's cool? Watch this. You can grab these points. Now, by the way, everyone knows how to build a parameter if you build families, right? So I could build parameters on this to control it, but I'm just pushing and pulling it because I'm not gonna show you how to build that. I'm assuming you can do that. Okay, so anytime I have a point here, like I showed you, you could do that. But watch this. oh my gosh, you select all the points that you want to move in rotation. And if you had like an object up here, you just grab this and watch this. There's your inverse kinematics. How cool is that? All right. Okay, one more thing. Now, one more thing. If you notice this too, watch this. Do you see how this, like for example, we have the cut sheets right here, yeah? So when I get the point, by the way, does anyone believe this is Revit? This is the Revit user group, right? Okay, just making sure. All right. Right here, check this out. Oh, super cool. Okay, this can move to here, but the way I have it right now, it can actually fold in on itself, right? It goes past. So basically, see this first linkage? It can go from here, based on the cut sheet, to maybe about there, right? To maybe about here, based on the cut sheet, okay? You see what I'm saying? So, do you know, like, when you set this parameter up, you could put a parameter here to say, okay, if it's this far, then make it like this, or if and if and limits, right? Forget, right? Because you're not stuck. Which means if you break these, you've got yourself natural buffers. So now I cut that thing off, I push this, and then wham, it won't go any farther. How cool is that? Okay, limited words. All right, cool. Okay, clap it up. Let's move on. All right. Oh, we're just starting. Okay, good. How are we doing? All right. Yeah, starting. What is this? Holy smokes. I don't know what to say. I'm slightly nervous. Okay. So next, I'm going to run count. Right? That's the next step. Want to know how to build count, really? Really easy. Well, it would take longer than 4 minutes. I basically have a little video here to show you how to do it. Okay? I don't like videos, but I had to cheat. Here it is. Okay.
Sorry. Where are you?
That's how to build a phone. Okay, so basically, today's technology, you just go out and get yourself a camera and take a picture of a cow, right? Use a cat to build a mesh. What do you do? Okay, got it? Build a mesh cleaner. Now you've got a cow, or if you happen to have a cow, a mesh off the internet, get that, okay? Then all you do is buy a rod of this into Rhino, you can do 3ds Max. Just basically cut it up so that you make one of the things from here all the way back to my mind. Make sure that those are continuous, transitions on the profiles. That's the key to making any very complex shape in Revit. You see how that is? Okay. Do you see the profiles? How they just kind of, whoops, how they just, did I lose everybody? Okay, hey, you told me I have to show you how to account for it. I'll stop it in a second.
There.
Boom, 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 boom. Go across head, ears, nose, tip of nose. Bang. Right? And then when you lost it, away you go. Wham, you got yourself a metal cow. Boom. There's the skin. There's some fur. Any questions? Don't worry. The point here is just if you're going to make complicated shapes in Revit, you have to do them with profiles. Yes? If you do them with profiles, make sure your profile from one to the next is a very gradual change. You can't go from this to this. You can't go from this to this. You have to go from this to this to this to this to this. If this has about 19 profiles, the elephant has about 40. If this has about 1900 arrows, the elephant has about 2000. Okay? Cool. All right. My website also goes through my blog site also goes step by step. That was just me recording how to do it, but it goes step by step in very slow increments. Boy, this is This is. Okay, so yeah, you're like, that's all fine and dandy, but what are we going to do with a cowl? Well, a cowl was one of those things, okay, can it be done? So let's talk about now how to work with complex surfaces inside of Revit, right? Maybe you've got a wrapping facade and you want to be able to put a floor into it. You want to have the floor be able to follow that edge. I like to use the cowl as an example. Plus, we're kind of familiar with it now. So I'm going to go there, go here, go here. Okay, so we got the cowl. Right, here we go. Ooh, there it is. Okay, that's cow. By the way, those are Revit walls. And you just get a mass and then you just host the wall to it. Okay. That's a wall. All right, so here we go. Let's just say, for example, we have a building the size of a cow and we want to be able to put a slab on the third floor. Okay? So basically what you do is you go to the third floor. What would you do right now? You want to activate your slab. Sorry, I'm more structural by some means, structural slab, but whatever. And then when you do pick, right, can you? Has anyone tried it? What are you going to do? Spline. Sorry, had to do that. No, watch this. All you do is, I think I messed it up, didn't I? I'm still in create mode, but I want to get out of create mode. There we go. No. Wait, yes. Okay. Okay, so watch this. So floor, circle floor, just build any old floor as like a way to start. Yeah, okay, no symbol. View 3D. Okay, here we go. Ready, watch this. I'm gonna hide this just for now so we can really, I'm gonna hide this just for now so we can really get in there. All right, now, what's the problem? The problem is that Revit doesn't allow you to pick something, but if there's a hard edge, it will. So if you have two solids and they intersect and you join them, guess what happens? You get a new entity. And that resulting geometry is pickable. So we go to modify, we go to join, we grab that slab we just put down, bang. We grab the wall, there we go, bang. Okay, we got that, boom. Now I'm gonna hide, I'm not gonna hide this, I'm gonna edit this boundary. I'm gonna take my pick tool now and I'm gonna zoom in, boom, you see it got it. Why did it get it? Because it is a hard edge, which is a resultant of a join, which creates a new entity, which is that cowl edge, right? And you following me? Okay, all right, so let me finish it out here. Okay, so I'm gonna go like this. I'm gonna delete all this other stuff. By the way, my kind of philosophy in Revit is a lot of people, when they model in Revit, is they think they have to use reference lines and reference planes. Well, those are guide elements, but you can use the other things inside of Revit, walls, floors, I use them all the time as like guide elements. Sometimes I call them sacrificial elements. So then, boom, this says the line is vicious, but the off-axis, and may cause inaccuracy. Oh my. There we go. Oh, come on now. Now it's going to say it can't join because now it's no longer like physically present. And there is the slab inside of Revit that's following that edge. Whoo, how cool is that? So these are real walls, by the way. So if you want to, I don't know. I'm not an architectural designer, but you know, I mean, maybe you want a basement. Okay. So any questions on that? Join, that's the key. Okay? I call that intersection method. 2012. Okay. How are we doing on time? Ah, oh, excellent on time. Okay. All right. Throw in Enscape. It's a lot of fun to walk around. Anyone use Enscape? If you're not using some kind of form of a real-time technology, I encourage you to. if we had more time, I would kick into Enscape and then walk through the doors and stuff. Kind of fun. All right, where are we at? You know, it would have been nice if we had kind of two monitors, one for my PowerPoint, and we'll do that next time. If you enjoy this, maybe I'll come back and we can do second best. All right, scale and morph in Revit. AU 2013, second place. That's because my other class got first place. how to scale using planting category. Oh, this is so easy. Anyone recognize what kind of column this is? Corinthian, yeah, right. So I modeled this inside of Revit, and I thought, you know what? A Corinthian is useless unless you're able to scale it, right? Proportionally. Okay, so it's really simple. This is actually got a tip from Revit's WordPress, so go check them out. They do awesome stuff. So what you do is just basically open, let me see here. Where are we at? Are we up here? Scale morph. I had to shift things around just because something didn't make sense to kind of put it in that order, chronological order. All right, so it's really simple. All you do is, here's the Corinthian, by the way, and anything you see in, that I'm doing up here, you get as a data set. Okay, so there's the Corinthian. Woo! Kind of, there it is, okay? So everyone can have that. And do renovation. So basically, watch it. It's really simple. All you do is you take a family and you stick it inside of a planting family, or you change the planting. Because plants will scale. They have a height parameter. If it doesn't have a height parameter, is that it? Yeah. And then you go over here, and it's only a type parameter. So I'm going to select on that. I'm not selecting. There we go. It's a type parameter that's 17 feet. I'll just make it kind of twice. I know it's not twice, but it's sort of twice. And then that's it. Bang. Yeah, see, I'm working. Now I get to spend more time on my other one. Why wouldn't you want your Corinthian column to not be in planting? No, I'm just kidding. Yes, and no. The question was, if you don't want that particular one to be in planting, nest it deep so it's in its category, and then nest it into a planting, and it'll do the same thing. Yeah, sure. The question was, could you switch category back after you do it? I never tried that, but I encourage you to give it a try. Oh, how many people like topography? All right, I'm going to show you. How many people like? Okay, so let's move on. We are on topography. All right, here we go. Where are we with this one? Yeah, AU 2013. First place.
Yay.
Okay, so I'm going to show you how to build a wall to follow topography. Okay, no Dynamo required here, although you could use Dynamo. Okay, I'm going to show you how to do it. It's pretty simple. There's a lot of steps, but it conceptually is pretty easy. Okay, so the first thing I was thinking about was the intersection method. Remember when we joined the two slab and cow wall? You didn't want cow wall, called a building wall, okay? Building wall, right, and slab. When we joined and we got that new entity, it was like, tick, tick. I thought it would be that simple on topography. No. But conceptually, it's the same. Let me show you. So first, you got to cut it. What cuts topography? Building pads. Building pads cut. Yeah! Okay, so let's cut it with a building pad. All right, here we go. Inside. Building pad. I'm going to do it between here, between A and B, and 1 and 2. There we go. Oh, my gosh. We're rolling now. All right, here we go. There. I just cut it, right? So now you can't just simply click this. Why? Because it's a mesh element, and it can't be clicked. But I've built a lot of beams in my time, and I knew that if topography can't be picked, it's a mesh. But mesh can be picked if it's inside of mass. So I thought, okay, well, I'm just going to send this out, isolate. I'm just going to send this out, export, okay? as a DWG. Yes, I said DWG. Okay? I didn't say AutoCAD, did I? I said Revit generated DWG. Yes? Okay, good. I had someone write me down and say, how dare you teach us AutoCAD methods in Revit class? I didn't say AutoCAD. I just said it now. But what I'm telling you is AutoCAD, right? Okay, bang. Right, bang. You send that out as isolated right there. Okay, I already sent one, but believe me, you send it out. Okay? Why did you send that out? This. Here we go. I sent it out. I start an in-place mask. Okay? And then I say, you know what? I'm going to insert, I'm going to link it. And I'm just going to say, send it right back in. Boom, it's right there. You see it? It fell right in place. Okay? For some reason, I don't know why, that you're allowed to actually do that. And you can actually pick it. So I'm going to go back to my site plan. I'm going to put a wall there. Should we use structural wall? I guess so. Structural wall along that edge right there. Okay, I'm going to go and do it because that's the wall I want to do. But it's just basically this, like, you know, my, I don't know what it is, but I'm having trouble with my painting and zooming. I don't know why. There it is, okay? So we're going to make the wall profile follow that just like we did the slab profile, okay? We have everything in place. Here we go. Slab profile. Right? Pick. Oh, look at that. Ooh, that's pretty. Okay, come zoom in here. You just go tab, bang. Now you got that edge. Okay? Now look, wait, I got to close it up first. Oh, I got to close it up. Okay, so let me just go this way. And do like this. You're like, Marcello, why are we doing this? You don't have to do this. If you want your wall to fall topography, go ahead and use that spline tool, you know, and do your click, 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 click. I mean, it's okay. I don't mind. I've had people completely scrap this idea because it involved a DWG. And I said, does it save you time? And they're like, yes. But strict policy in the office never to import or link DWG. I thought, well, you could delete that. Nope. Okay. Well, you know what? I'm not here to argue with you. I'm just showing you the method. You take it from there, you know? All right. So here you go. Copy. I'm just going to do like a vertical up. I'm just going to take this and just kind of send it up maybe 4 meters or something. And let me just close it to see if this really works. Now, if you're working with little tiny teeny bits, make sure you get in there, you know, get your hands dirty and zoom way in. Okay. And then hopefully you can close it. If you've got to use that friendly tab button if you need to. And then, you know, I get this about 50% of the time. I sure hope I get it now. Just to close it. There we go. Okay, I'm going to zoom out. This, I'm going to say close. And I'm going to get a message. Best way to control top and base of the wall is to modify the constraints and offset parameters in properties dialog box. Well, I guess no one in Revit that developed Revit built a wall that followed topo head. Because that message is meaningful. Okay, anyway, here we go. Right there it is. I'm going to go boom and isolate element, and there you go. Follow the topo. How's that? Okay. Get the apron in the way. I don't know. 20 you can do it. I can do that in about, with all my Jeff talking, I can do that in about
2 minutes.
Okay, where are we at? You know, I wasn't, there's a few things I have in here because I have taught other things at Autodesk University classes of the 21. One was how to basically engage your audience. So I thought probably one of the best tips was this. Maya Angelou said it great, and I'm a firm believer in this, which is, she says, I learned that people will forget what you said, will forget what you did, but you don't know, like, you probably forgot a little quick, but I did a while ago, right? But people will never forget how you made them feel. All right. So if you're presenting, that's what you want to do. You want to make sure you understand, get connected with people. Tell them how you feel. Get how they feel. Throw it out there, right? Yeah, it was a great presentation. Why? Oh, it made me feel great. Right? So anyway, that's my kind of tip for you. If you want to get a top speaker, just do that.
All right.
Here we go. Okay. Whew. This, I will not do the Dynamo solution, I'll do the Revit solution for this, but basically, let's build a jet engine. Okay, you're like, Marcello, why would we ever build a jet engine? Oh, this actually has a lot of implications. Okay, so we got Dynamo practical, here we go. All right, start. Whoops, I rolled that incorrectly. I gave away the punchline. Let me see. Here we go. Okay, so the engine's context is it's part of this airplane. All right, everyone gets this, you can have it. I know the 747 is kind of getting outdated, but anyway, you see the idea, right? See that engine right there? That's what we're going to build. We're going to build a casing for that engine. Why does that make it so special? Because it actually moves in on itself, okay? The loft. It's got that kind of smooth engine, maybe like a sink, maybe. I'm trying to think of other examples that you can do that. Why is that a big deal? Well, because Revit does not respect profile order. You're like, what is that? I'll tell you what it means.
I will show you.
Okay, so check this out. Here is that engine. All it is basically three profiles, 1, 2, and 3, okay? Let's call this 1. Let's call this 2 on the very end and this 3. I need it to go from 1 to 2 and fold into 3. Got it? Okay. If I were just to click these 3 in any order, believe me, I tried many different times to pick order doesn't matter. If you hit create form, it's always going to do this. Why? Because it's respecting what's the closest one. There's a formula that runs. These are actually called Hermite formulations. And that's what it does. Okay, you can never let it, you can never control profile order. You understand? Okay. Or can you? Right. So I thought, you know what? I could go to Dynamo, but we're not at Dynamo yet. So I could go to, I'm like, you know what? When I was doing this, I'm like, you know what? It would be great if it always extrudes like that. Well, then what if I move this one out here? Okay, I'm gonna get a little, we're gonna get a little wild and crazy, okay? Here, I'm gonna set this. I love to use things that are not meant to be used for things. Okay, so I'm gonna take this and I'm gonna build a boss here. Okay. Why a box? Because it's got nice flat faces. Okay, see that? Maybe I'll bring this up a little bit more. Okay? I'm going to project this onto that surface. Ready? Like why?
You'll see why.
I'm gonna pick that right there, okay? I just projected it on. You know that's how you project something onto the surface in massing? Did you want to see it again? I set that, I click pick, I picked that, smacked it onto that. Why? Because that's the set work plane. Yes?
Sort of.
Now I got that right there. I got this one and this one. Now I'm gonna say, make them all. I'm then going to say create form. Because I know it's going to always shoot out like that. And then, what do you think I got to do with this? Drag it back into place. Woo! Bang. Done. Thank you, block. And thank you.
How cool is that?
Just kind of the sound of the box, right? All right, there's a Dynamo solution there. You can pick the theme and then do it with reorder, and don't worry about that. I can do them just as quick, either one, but there's a Dynamo solution. Okay. Yes, we got 55 minutes. Oh, we are cooking. Any questions? You want me to slow down? Okay, we are finally going to get to Revit. Dynamo, excuse me. Okay. All right. Surface area ramp. I did a class, Dynamo for Contractors, 2015. Okay. Dynamo. All right. So don't be bashful. How many people have used Dynamo? Let me clarify. That means you would have to have at least placed a couple nodes yourself. You would have to have run the graph yourself, and you would have to wait for the results yourself. Okay, cool. Now, anyone who has not used Dynamo, don't worry, I'll watch through it. We'll do this first example, thoroughly, and then we'll take it off because they're almost inseparable now, okay? Dynamo and Revit. There's a time for it, and there is a time not for it. Okay. Oh, boy. Okay, let's do it. How are we doing over there? We we were on Lord live streaming, aren't we? Holy smokes. So a contractor asked me, I have a curved ramp. I want to get the surface area of it because I need to paint it. It wasn't painting. It was actually four more calculations. Okay. Yeah, you don't need the top for four more calculations, probably, right? But we'll get it. Are you getting a blur there? Is that just me? It's okay. It's okay. All right. So I'm going to click this. I'm going to leave it right there. Now, so someone in their office said, hey, you know what? If you want to get the surface area of Revit off an object, well, just look at its properties and its instance properties. Does anyone see surface area in those instance properties? Anyone? No, what do you see? It's very limited, right? What do you see? Width? Oh, my gosh. Hard to see back here. I apologize. I can't zoom in. I'm sorry.
Okay, for all of you,
what do you see there? Width. Is that going to help you? Sure, you could do radius and width and arc length, right? Pop that in Excel and have yourself. Or you can think, Revit is limited in what it can display for ranks. Okay? Could you schedule that in Revit? No, so this is the point where you say, You know what? I got a good friend. I got a really good friend. I'm going to ask them if they know how to get the surface area of a ramp. Hey, Dynamo. Yes? Revit? Do you know how to get the surface area of a ramp? I know how to get the surface area. Great. I'm going to pass my ramp object to you. You give me the surface area. Okay? Let's do it. So that is one of the reasons to use Dynamo. Do you understand? Okay. Because as you start to think about Dynamo and you start to want to use it in your office, people will be like, why, right? Like, well, it's cool and fun. Okay, yeah, but why else? Right? Well, you can't get the surface of that area ramp easily, right? But my friend Dynamo could. All right, so Dynamo's like your wing person. So let's do it. Ready? All you need to do is select the ramp in Dynamo. Here's Dynamo. This is the environment. A bunch of stuff on your left. This is a visual programming language. Right, Revit, what we're going to do is select the ramp. I'm going to use it select. There's many different selection methods. I'm going to use select by category. Can anyone tell me, the non-Dynamo users, what you think I would pick for this category? Just shout it out. What would I pick for this category? Anyone? Come on now. Ramp. Yeah, there you go. Cool ramp. Yeah, easy, right? All right, you're already Dynamo user. Okay. One more thing is you just have to pick all the elements of it because that's just the category. You pick all the elements. There it is. It also uses basically if you want to connect it, information flows from here to here. You just basically click on it and you do that. And you see how these two line up? They're like kiss, right? Right. That's his category. That's his category. That's very important. These types are similar or the same. That's important. Okay. So we do that. Boom. Okay. Then you say, Revit says, hey, you know what? Dynamo, you told me you can get the surface area. Like, oh, yeah, I can get the surface area. Right here. Surface area. I can get the surface area. Okay, pass that to me. And then you connect this up, and nothing happens. Revit says, you just told me you can get the surface area. And Dynamo says, what is a ramp? Oh, you don't speak my language, Dynamo. No, I don't. You are speaking Revit. Okay, I speak. Anyone? I speak Dynamo language. So how are we going to communicate? Well, maybe like in Star Trek, we can use that like universal translator. The developers built them for us. You may not think about it that way, but that's what they are. Okay. So it says, you know what? Can you take that universal translator, go in into that ramp and extract the surfaces, and then I can understand it. We're like, oh yeah, it's easy. Watch this right here. Boom. Revit. Element. Element again. I don't like to type in here because it gives me. And then this is called faces. It's it inherits from surface, so it still works. But look, there we go. There we go. Boom. These are all the faces. In fact, there it is. There's a preview geometry right there. Oh, nice. Universal translator is working. Good, good, good. And then we come over here and we say, okay, give me all the surface areas. Oh, there they are. Right there. Okay, that's super cool. Does everyone get that? Okay. You're like, that's not useful for me because there's six surfaces, by the way. Using programming language, it starts at zero, not one. It starts at zero, okay? That's right. All right. So, hey, you know what? You need to sum that up for me. Donald was like, I got a sum note. Can I use it, please? Yes, please. Use it. All right, right there. Right? Boom. 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 Done. There it is. Okay. Ooh, look at that huge number. That is square millimeters. Why? Because the Revit units are set for area of millimeters squared. So Dynamo knows how to use Revit, right? You're like, I don't like that. Fine. Well, you can put variables in here like an X and feed this in, and then you'll just get the same thing. But what if you want to convert it? You can do that too. You can put in this. I'm going to divide, I'm going to make it square meters. So I'm going to divide by 1,000 first, and then by 1,000 again. And bang, now I got square meters. 21.89 square meters, right? Oh, I want to round it up. Fine, that's a rounding note, okay? Just, goodness. Does anyone get it, right? Just boom, 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 boom. Why? Because Dynamo can access the Revit database. That's why, all right? You can write that back in. You can take a screenshot. You can email it to your friend. You can even write that to a scale, whatever. But that's just kind of an introduction into Dynamo. How does that make sense? Okay, how cool is that? Dynamo. No? All right. Okay. Well, fine. I thought, you know what? What about if you wanted to do painting calculations on something complex? Could Revit do surface areas of something complicated? Absolutely. So we'll run that same script, by the way, so I would save it. I would change the Revit category from like something else. And then it would select it all. And then, there we go. Oh, did I move that? Oops, whoa. What happened? Should do it. There we go. Here we go, right? Element faces, it flattens it. Surface area, sum, da, 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 right? Boom, boom. Okay. Any questions about that? You want to see if it works? Me too. We're done, crash. All right, we'll let that think. And then, anyway, you get the idea, right? You want to do painting calculations? Okay. Oh man, look at that. I don't know why. I'm rather surprised this is happening. Maybe because we're learning a lot. It worked out. Okay. Anyway. All right. Let's move on. We'll check with that later. Okay. So let's take a break from Dynamo. We're going to use this one really quick. Okay. Let's take a break from Dynamo and let's talk about laying down some structure. Okay. How are we doing on time? Okay. Perfect. Wow. I have to show that. All right, I'm gonna have to kill that. Ah, I guess Revit took a Dynamo took it over there. It was about time. Okay, come on. Okay, new session, Revit. All right, so how many people in here have to model structure?
Really?
Architects, I hope you raise your hand. All right. Okay, so let's talk about this.
Here we are.
Let's talk about this. Cutting edge structural modeling technique was the class. Build North America 2017. Okay, so basically, we want to be able to orient beams to a surface. Okay, so let me kind of set it up for you. Did we lose the other one? Yeah, we did. That's too bad. I tested it right before we got here. All right. It is really. All right. So here we go. Okay. So I'm going to. I jumped ahead. Here we go. Okay. So let's say we have a situation where we have a curved roof, right? And we have a beam that we have to model that has to actually follow. The top flange actually has to be rotated based on the curve. See what I'm trying to get at? Well, what do you do now? Right, you take your structural beam, you may do your 3D snapping, you come over here, come over there, you got it about there, you come over here, you look down the barrel, you come over here. For the people in the back, I'm changing the cross-sectional rotation parameter, maybe -3. I almost got it. Maybe 36? Maybe 40? Yay, 40 is a lucky number. Okay, next one. There we go. Yeah. Okay, come on. Okay, forget all that, right? Watch this. I'm going to show you the power of an adaptive component and a repeater. All right, so basically this is a circle. So you're going to edit this. Let me get rid of these edge ones, just so we're not confused. All right, we can edit this in place, and we can divide this surface. Okay. We can also break it up into however many we want. Like I'm going to do a 1x12 in this case. Okay. So those represent my beam locations. All right. Also, you have, if you don't know, in your surface representation, you can also turn on a node. Did you see where that came from? There's a little itty-bitty arrow right there, okay? See it? Boom, nodes. Why is that important? Well, adaptive components, two-point adaptive components, so we'll get into that point a little bit, when you host them onto node of a divided surface, you have the ability to repeat them, because there's something called a... But the beauty about this is, let me show you my, let me open this up. Here's my beam. It's just basically a two-point adapter with just basically a two by four. But you can make any profile you want. You can even set this to a tight parameter so that it can change all your different cross sections and whatever. Okay. So you basically have a two-point adaptive component. If you don't know what a two-point adaptive component is, it just means when you bring it into your project environment or anywhere it's going, it's going to ask you, okay, where do you want point one? Where do you want point two? Got it? Basically, all it's going to do. Okay. But it's so smart that if it's hosting onto a divided surface, it's going to know the orientation of that surface. You see where I'm going with this? So all you have to do is go like this, bang. I'm gonna go there, and you see that little like circle? It's kind of hard to see. And you'll get another one over here, bang. And it just, the whole point of an adaptive component is it just loves to host onto divided surfaces nodes and divided path nodes. So you got that? Now, if you look over here, there's this thing called P, it says a P there. It says repeater. That might stand for pattern. I don't know. Anyway, you just click that. Ready? Bang. That's it. One and done. Right? Or if you want to, you can get a little creative. We've got a little time. You can select the divided surface if you wanted to. Maybe you didn't like that layout. You can make the number a parameter. Framing, you can control number, all that kind of stuff. Okay, I'm gonna finish this and turn everything back on, you see how I have that in there? I can select on this again. I can actually change this number. Maybe I want 26. See that? Maybe I want 100, right? That's what I want. Why 100? Because it's fun, and it's fun to break it. That's one. Can't go over 201, I think. I'm not exactly sure. But everyone, get that. Let me go up here for there. Ooh, that's a pretty shot. Look at that. All nice and oriented. Okay. Anyone get it? Adaptive components. Now, someone can ask me, yeah. That's not a structural beam. No, it's not. Okay, you can use Dynamo to do kind of the same thing with that. My blog site showed you how to do it with structural beams. But if you're laying out framing and you want to get something in, the adaptive component is amazing because it can follow those surfaces. Okay? And if you don't know what adaptive components are, run to your office when you get back, whenever you get back, and look it up. Okay. Hey, Beth, about that. No? Okay. How are we doing on time? Oh, yes. We got 38 minutes. You know what? I still have to take a break from Dynamo. So we're going to talk about this. All right. So do you remember how we actually rotated using the ride the rail method? But we had a circle and a point. What was that? So if you want to use the classic family editor, well, they don't have points, right? So you got to come up with a different method, but it's rather easy. So I'm going to show you how to actually use rotation on a also a multi-joint family. That's this telehandler down here, right? But you can use it on anything like door swings, by folding doors, you know, other things like that. Okay, but I think it's kind of fun to do it on the more interesting family. All right, so watch it. It's really simple. Sorry. Okay, here we go. So we're going to go to... So all I'm going to do is here's the base, right, of that telehandler, okay? And everyone gets to have these families and play with them, okay? First thing you need to do is there's that first part of the boom that's going to be moving up and down, right? Okay, if you want to control that with your reference lines and that three reference lines, you know, have at it, okay? Let me show you another method to do it, okay? And then it's also got a piece in there that telescopes out too. You know, that's got a fork on the end of it, okay? So we're going to do both. We're going to do rotation and we're going to do telescopic motion, just like we did with that handle wall lift, okay? So we're kind of running through the same process, but in the classic family. You know what I mean by the classic family editor? Anything that you can edit, a family editor that is not massing or adaptive in nature. Okay, so it's the stuff you kind of all know and love. Right? Windows, doors, balusters, telehandlers. Okay? All right. Okay, so I'm just trying to let you open your mind and kind of think about this. All right, so. And I was thinking about this, and I did the right to rail method called the rail method. I was like, how do we do it in the classic family environment? I'm like, how do I make something move and rotate? Yeah. So I walked out my front door, and I opened my door, and I looked at the hinge, and I was like, that's it, a revolve. Okay, a revolve works very similar to a ride the rail method. Why? Because of this reason. And I'll show you. Okay, so let me set this up. You can kind of put this anywhere. I want to make a revolve. I'm going to say set. I'm just going to happen to put it right on the tip of these forks. You certainly don't have to do that. You can put it kind of anywhere you want. It's not selecting that one. There it is. Boom. Okay. Now, revolve. Okay. Here we go. Axis line. I'm going to draw it from here. Because these are two pins that would kind of rotate that first boom. You got it? That's where it rotates. Everyone follow me? Why I put a rotation line here? Yes? Okay. Good. I'm going to say, now my boundary line, it may seem a little arbitrary, but I'm going to put it like that, okay? And you'll see why I'm doing this. Okay, you're like, oh, yeah, that's kind of cool. Watch this. You're able to open these things up. It doesn't have to go from 0 to 360. It can go from 0 to whatever. Look at that pretty flat surface that you can put stuff on. Not only that, but you can make it a parameter. Oh. So simple. Watch this. I'm going to turn this to 180. Okay, let's get that first bloom in here. Where is it at? Is it here? There it is. I'm just going to kind of estimate it. Now, I built this bloom in another part of the family, but we're just going to kind of, we just got to kind of nudge it into place. Now, we're not being very exact, right? I mean, I'm going to get it about there, but I need to rotate it. So I got to tab this thing, and I'm going to get it over. So I'm just kind of estimating, but you get what I'm saying, right? You can have fun and make it exact if you want. Okay, watch out, watch this. So I'm not setting any parameters, but look how easy this is. Doesn't this just seem so natural? Watch, I'm just gonna grab this and I'm just gonna rotate the zone. Come on, man. Go ahead. All right. There you go, better. All right. Good. All right, I'm gonna hide this. What about the telescope? What about telescope? Right? And I thought, how am I gonna telescope? I need to like extrude. How am I gonna make something telescope? I'm gonna extrude something. Okay, so you watch this. Same thing. All right, don't want to keep saying let's have it. Okay, so. So I'm just building an extrusion here based on this. Boom, it just happens to be that same, right? So then when I move this, that will move, you understand? Okay, so I'm gonna take that. I'm gonna bring in my telescope. I'm gonna set this onto that face. I'm going to then get my boom end, and then I gotta rotate it into place. Don't worry about that. Didn't have time to fix that. And then there we go. I gotta get it in place again. So let me look here. Speed it in place. I'm just gonna rip it. Okay, now look at this. So if I want to rotate, I just go like this. And you see that relative movement? And if I want to telescope, then I just do this one. Right? And I can set up these parameters, right? You see there? I want to. Then oh, sorry, how cool is that? All right, yay. Okay, so just think about using angular parameters and other straight dimension, you know, kind of think there are other options. I'm not saying you have to go back to your office, change all your family. I'm just saying you got to send back parts for you. Okay, one more thing. I had someone run me down when I showed this. They're like, how dare you put all that extra stuff in my family? I'm never using that method. Why not? Because now that stuff is going to show up in my family. Oh, really? So, you know, you don't have to show that stuff as it goes into the project environment, okay? You can make it invisible if you like. All right, cool. I don't need to put on the force, do I? No, okay. Here is the final product, though. Here's the final product you get this to. Okay, but you could put on the force, too, if you want, right? And then you could even, in the rotation, the last one you put on the tip of the fork, if you want, because those forks always have to be horizontal to the earth, you can always just make that parameter for that tip of that rotation. You could always just make it equal to the angle of the boom, and then those forks will always be vertical if they need to move, or whatever else you're doing. Okay, so it's just kind of more complicated rotation thing, but just kind of think about that. So I'm going to move this, and those forks should stay vertical. Yay! Work. Oh, you're looking at that? Yeah. They just. Yeah. I didn't have time to fix it. Please ignore that. All right. Okay. More rotation? Like rotation? I got one more rotation. Okay. So we talked about rotation in 2D, right? What about rotation in 3D? I'll show you this. This is my fave. Oh my gosh, I had to throw this in. Okay, here we go. So, okay, one more. So I thought I'd bring back the Revit cow. And I thought, you know what? Gosh, How about the way ahead of a cow moves, right? It doesn't move in one way, right? It can rotate, kind of like a ball joint. So if you want ball joint movement, then all you have to do is host this. And by the way, this point will move the head, okay? Just, I built the cow that way, okay? Just build it. But that's unrealistic because it won't move its head like this and like this, right? It sees that grass, it's gonna go wham, and go straight there, which is a combination of multiple, right, axis movement, right? Anyone guess maybe what do you think? We hosted the point on a circle so it can move around in a circle. What do you think we can host that point to make it move around like a... Almost.
Good guess.
Who said hemisphere?
Good.
Hemisphere. So let's build a hemisphere. How do you build a hemisphere, Rayo? Just like we built the revolve. You just build yourself a sphere, and then you hold this, and you just open that up. Maybe we go 180. This is not 18. Oh, goodness. This mouse, I don't have much room. There we go, right? And then take that, bang, and go pick your house. Put it anywhere you want. Boom. And now, that point will slide around on there, and that cow will be happy because it's moving its head in a realistic way. Cool stuff? If the whole geometry is checking out, the invisible will it still move along and close? Absolutely. Because you're only making it invisible, you're not making it, you're not deleting it. I never really thought about that before, but yeah. Check it out. I haven't verified it, but logically, it would still work. Okay, that's my answer to you. But if you want to have a conversation, geek out about that later and try it, please follow me. Okay, I'm still going to be avoiding Dynamo for the moment, and I want to talk about more structural beams. Okay, so everyone want to do some more structural beams? Yeah, okay, so how many people were... Oh, okay, so here we go. Check on time. Oh, yeah, rocking and rolling. Love it. All right, so let's see. Okay, structural beam framing. Now, whether you're an architect, a structural engineer, or an MEP or an owner, I would imagine you're opening up the structural models, or at least the structure in your Revit models, and you're looking at it. Yes? Good. Now, are you taking it for granted that it's perfect in every way? Trust that structural engineer, or hold on, Revit model it, that it's 100% correct. Should you do that? I mean, it's worth a peek. That's all I'm saying. So I'm going to show you some ways just to peer into it to like quality control it on a very nice level. Okay. So now, does this framing look pretty good? That looks pretty good. Yeah. Is it really good? You're viewing it at a macro level, right? Now, I want to open everyone's eyes again to something. How many people turn off the analytical model in their Revit model? Oh. Okay. I taught a class basically how to use analytical models for things other than analysis. Okay. One of them is, it is a very good of the health of your roof ramp. So go here, turn it on, right? I'm not saying turn it on, I'm saying, you know what I mean. I'm not telling you what to do. I'm saying I would turn it on. Now I take a peek. And I'm gonna just cruise down this curve. I'm not so sure about that. So it's not even connecting to my girder. That one either. That one. Do you see what happens? The nodes at the end of the member of the element start to have a telltale sign. Right? Okay, what about this column? Looks pretty good. If these all came into one point and I hovered over that node, how many nodes should I be picking? One. How many do I got in that? Sorry, this side of the room. How many do I have in that bottom right corner? Four. I'm gonna zoom in there. I mean, okay, hold on. That may be correct, right? Maybe. Maybe, right? If you're not the structural engineer, you say, hey, you know what? You gotta be nice about these kind of things, right? Because we're all a team. You gotta be, especially with the structural engineers, you gotta be really nice about it. You know, I was looking at your model and I was printing, I was printing it out and putting it up on my cubicle and admiring it. I just so happened to notice. In this case, there was four nodes. I thought it was so pretty. They're like, that's good. Where? Okay. We'll get you a new model tomorrow. All right. You're like, no. Don't give me a new model. I will. I'll fix it myself. Okay. All right. Maybe you're not allowed to fix it yourself, but I'm going to show you. Like myself, that's all fine and dandy. How do you fix that? I'm going to show you. But if you, here's the thing, by the way, everyone does. This is how I look at things. Even if I never use it, I want to learn it because I know someone in my team who may want to use it. So I'm going to be like, I'm not going to fix that, but I know how to fix it. Now I'm the architect. I'm going to go tell my structural engineer nicely, hey, you know what? You can do this in half the time.
You want to show it?
Oh, yeah, show me now.
Okay, perfect.
Oh, we're so chum. Structural engineer, architect, MEP, contractor, owner, civil, right? Okay, well, you got to breathe that kind of culture in your offices, okay? Because we're all a team. All right, that's my team. All right. By the way, I'm case in point. I never, ever want model photography in my life. Ever. Ever. But I knew there was a need in the industry to try to figure out how to do it. So I spent my time to figure out how to do it. I helped some architects that we were working with. I helped some of the civil engineers and helped the industry and the planet, right? So just, you know, think about those kind of things as you kind of pick things that you want to like. I'm not telling you to learn everything, but you know, kind of get a people pulse on what people are doing in your office and outside your office on your team. And, you know, maybe contribute even if you're not asked to. I teach a class at Autodesk University coming up kind of on that topic, like, you know, being a hero and kind of looking outside just what you do in your office. Okay. Sorry, I had to say that. Okay. Where were we? Fixing. Okay, here we go. So, here we go. So how do you fix it? Super cool, super easy. All right, so turn on that analytical model. Okay, ready? Boom. Don't worry, you can turn it right back off. All right, look right there. Ooh, there's a problem right there. Okay, I'm going to fix that. All right, so what you do is you could either call analytical adjust. Just that line. Pick that point, pick new host, and then you go like that, and you say finish. That didn't move that thing, did it? Okay, we'll get it. All right. So there's no really way to align this to that because there's no thing to pick here. And I was like, there's nothing to pick there. I'm like, why don't I make my own pick thing? So, and at the front, right? Go to plan, top view, right? Just draw a line. Ready? Here. Align it here. Bang, bang, lock it. Bang, bang, lock it. What am I doing? I'm just drawing a line so I can see the darn thing. Where did you go? Oh no. There you are. Bang. What did I do? That's what I do. Okay. If you want, I'll build one for you. Okay. Load that back in. Bang. Bang. Ooh, here it comes. Oh, so pretty. And by the way, if you do this, you can start to see the center line line up too, right? Okay. So just, you know, and then, you know, hey, I don't want that in my model. Okay. Remember that little visibility thing you talked about? So anyway, here, bang. We know that's in the right spot. Maybe, right? You don't know which is which. I'm assuming that those want. Okay, I mean, I'm a structural engineer. So we're supposed to line up. Sometimes they don't, right? Okay, fine. But they do. Which one's the right one? That one on the left is right. Is the correct one, and this one is not. So we have to line them up. Anyway, boom and boom. How cool is that? Yes, you like it? Okay, cool. So I did this and I was like, you know what? I started doing this and I was like, you know what? Whoops. I was like, you know what? I'm tired of moving this. So So I went like this.
Oh my gosh,
I'm getting goosebumps. I went like this, structural beam, pow. And I was like, what did I just do? Oh my gosh, I just put a line, a two-point line, with 2 points at the end of it, controlled where it was, and then snapped the beam to it, right? I was like, oh, I don't know if it was analytical. Oh my gosh, my whole world just exploded when I did this. I was like, oh. By the way, I am 5 times faster building roof framing now. Let me show you something. Or show, you know, like, okay. So here we go. Next one, watch this. Oh, okay, here we go. Oh my gosh, I'm getting really excited. Okay. Where would it be? I kind of moved everything around here. I'm too excited. Here we go. So what is an analytical line? It's just a point, just a line with 2 points at the end of it. Well, isn't an adaptive component also that too? I'll just show you, right? Doesn't that kind of look like the analytical line? Okay, so let's make one. I'll show you how to make one really quick. Ready? Watch this. New family generic model adaptive. Spline 2 points, yes, spline 2 points. 1, 2. Put them anywhere you want. 1, 2, select it, say you can adapt. Easy, right? If you want one, I'll make one for you. Okay, load it in. Here we go. And then where we go? Move from here. And let's say I want to make the beam, oh, I don't know, 25% along that arc length, right? Well, the cool thing about an adaptive component is you can host that point to curves, you can host it to surfaces, and you can control its location. So if along that curve of that beam, if I wanted to be at the corner point, then what would this value be, normalized value? 0.25, right? You're like, Marcello, okay, where are you going with this? So I can go like this. You're like, no big deal. I'll do that anyway with my structural beam. Oh yeah, good luck. Good luck finding the quarter point. I get, oh, I get that point. Oh, there's my midpoint. Where's my quarter? Where's my third? Right? So do you see when you use an adaptive component, you can actually control in a very easy way beam location, right? You want to wait for your structural engineer to frame an opening? Hello. Right? No? Right, and then you just, when you're all done, you go bang, 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 bang. How cool is that? What do you think about that? Think about it, okay? Like, you know what, Marcello? You know what, I like this, but when, gosh darn it. Where's it at? There it is. Where is my adaptive line? There it is. When my, I keep placing it. Oh my gosh, I keep picking it. No one stopped me. When this moves, the beam doesn't move with it, right? Okay, so, well, what if you said, Dynamo, hey Dynamo, can you place beams on lines? Absolutely, just tell me where the curve is. Okay, so I'm gonna show you a little script here. I'm not gonna place all the nodes, but now we're back in Dynamo, okay? You don't have to use Dynamo, right? You can just go click, 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 but if you want to, you can. So I'm just gonna say open. Oh, it's right here. It's pretty cool. It's really simple. So you just go, here we go. So basically all it does is it takes the family, it was called two-point adapt, that's what I called it. You select all the types, it pulls the element curves. Does anyone remember what we called this? The universal translator, right? You pull in an element, it comes out a curve. Now this just places structural family. I always place my framing on level one. So I know because my that's the exercise of the beam. And I can hit run. And boom, there it is. Hopefully my Dynamo script hasn't been running. There we go. See, there it is. And then you can actually turn this to automatic, let it run in the background, and you can have yourself a framing party. Hear the music, I hope. Boom, 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 boom. Right, frame. And then once you cancel out of that, bang, there goes the beams. How cool is that? Yeah. Okay, how are we doing on time? 15 minutes. Are we doing okay over there? Okay. 15 minutes. They're shaking their heads over there. Like, what's going on? Any questions? How's the pace? Doing good? Okay. I know it's a lot, but come on now. 21 classes. 90 minutes. Holy smokes.
Okay.
All right. by the way, I'll be available after to hang out if you have any questions, and then also if you want to comment, you can do that. Okay. Should we take a break from beans? Let's take a break from beans. Yes, yes. Come on, Marcel. I know I'm kind of structure heavy, but like I said, if you're MEP and you're a construction contractor and you're an architect and you're not paying attention to structural framing, then you're doing something wrong in your office. Okay, so. Pay attention. All right, so here we are. Let's check out this comic. So I did a class called. I did a class called Who Models What in Our Structural Office? Because in the structural office, is anyone here in the structural office or manage people in the structural office? Okay, so there are Revit models and there are analytical models. Is that correct? Revit models and analytical. I suppose you can relate this to like Revit models and. No, not quite. One that would do analysis. So maybe some of your some of your daylighting, right, or some of your energy models, maybe in architecture, right. So there are many different models in the office, right. So I did a roundtable. Dan was there, and I think a few others. And this is I was like, how do I summarize that? So I summarized it in comic form. And this is basically it. But too bad I punched line. Most people can't read it. But yeah, you noticed that, huh? Yeah, they were. But just ever so subtle. Anyway, read this in your leisure. But basically, it's basically saying that we got to share. Everyone can't read it. The effect kind of got lost. But next time, we'll do it then. Right. But read the comic. I do all these comics myself, by the way. I really like it. It's a lot of fun. Okay. Anyone want to do any C-sharp coding? Woo-hoo. You want to build a Dynamo node?
Zero touch?
Maybe we'll end on that. Okay. So, let's do it. Dynamo. Okay. So I do have a Dynamo package out there. It's called Simplex. It's got about 1,800 nodes in it because it's got Dynamo for ETABS, Dynamo for SAP, Dynamo for Tekla, and then a few and then the Dynamo cows in there as well. So check it out if you have time. It also can take it can also extract Word text from Word files. Okay, so where were they going with that? Dynamo. That's all done through, so Dynamo is an add-in to Revit. I don't know if you can argue it's still an add-in, but basically Dynamo has packages that you can customize for Dynamo. So maybe you've gone through and you've looked at all out-of-the-box nodes for Dynamo, and now you need to write your own nodes, right? It's not that difficult at all. I'm going to show you how to do it. Basically, all these custom packages are based on something called Zero Touch and C Sharp. Anyone C Sharp coders in here? Oh, I'll turn you into C Sharp coders after this. Think I can do it? Okay, so that's some kind of example. Let's talk about it. So, December, I will be celebrating my 20th anniversary at my company. Thank you. So, the very next question people ask me is, how old are you? So I thought I'd have a little fun. Let's write a little script to find out how old I am, okay? And that will be our Dynamo node. How's that sound? Are we okay? What's going on? Okay. All right. So in order to write a Dynamo node, you just basically need to have a class. Don't worry if you don't know what that is. And you need to have a method. Don't worry if you don't know what that is. I'll show it to you. It's pretty simple. Can I get this back? Can we lose a few or something? Okay. Ready to go? All right. So I'm going to load this in, but here it is. Okay, don't get intimidated. Let's just give it a try. We're going to give it a try. I'm just going to attempt it because we're wild and crazy. Okay, let's do it. So you got to first go get Visual Studio. Don't worry, C Sharp is not that complicated, especially for when you have to do custom nodes for Dynamo. Okay, So as you saw, Dynamo has input ports and it has output ports, okay? Most important thing with the Dynamo node is that it has an output port. It doesn't have to have an input port because Dynamo does something and kicks out a result, okay? So that's what we're gonna do. We're gonna chew on Marcello's age and we're gonna kick out the result. That's all we're gonna do. So basically, I will show you how to do it. You've got a loading reference depending on what database you're talking to. And then you gotta make a namespace. Namespace is like a book that holds classes. Classes are basically chapters that hold methods. Methods are routines that you do your stuff in. So that's basically what we gotta do. We gotta build a method or a function to find out Marcello's age, okay? And it's really easy. So think about this as like you drive down into a Revit model, right? You're like, you wanna know about this, right? You wanna know how tall it is, right? But first you gotta get to know it. You're like, well, what are you? I'm a desk, okay? And then what else? Well, I'm made of wood, okay, cool. And now what else? Tell me more and more about yourself. So that's how we're gonna do it. First you gotta meet me, first you gotta meet my friend, then you gotta meet me, and then you can ask me. Like, you can just walk up to me and go, hey, Marcel, how old are you? I mean, I'm friendly, you can do that. But you know, they don't do that, people, right? Excuse me, how old are you? Right, you wanna kinda, you know, kinda ease into those kind of things, right, for the person. Right, that's what we're gonna do. Okay, so first thing, you gotta create a method, just the stuff that holds everything. It's really not that hard. You just kind of make a, don't worry about much of this stuff. You want to even Google kind of what it means, but you just got to make a public static, what we call a public static method. And then you have to find out what type am I going to be. If it's going to be an age, it's probably going to not be a decimal number. You're like, hold you, I'm blank, 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 blank. You know, you don't need to do that, right? So you say, okay, I'm an integer. That's what I'm going to be. That's what I'm going to return. I'm going to return an integer because that's what people, I mean, unless you're, you know, unless it's a toddler and they say, oh, how old is that? Oh, 18 months, you know? And then, okay, where do you stop? I don't know. 24 months. Hey, 36 months, right? 48 months, you know, whatever, I don't know. And so, you know, practically, you know, as adults, we don't do that. So you've got to name the method. The method you name it is the name of that node, right? So, like, convert Revit geometry to Dynamo geometry. That was the name of that node. The name of my node is I'm going to call it Marcello Age node. Okay. All right. Okay. And then you basically encase it in this parentheses because you basically say I don't want any input. You just run. I don't want just run. The moment you drop on the canvas, run. Okay. You don't know what I mean. Okay. Now we're going to set up a variable which is an int. So we got to make an object. So we're going to say Marcello age object. Okay, this is just the object, and we're going to say equals. Now we're going to say equals the age, but you got to drive down. So what do you want to talk about? First of all, you want to get a group of friends together, just like you want to get, you know, like the category is. So you just say, okay, well, friends. Okay, of the friends, this is the most powerful thing in programming. It's the period. Oh my gosh, this is so awesome. Watch this. You press that, and it tells you everything available about it. Well, you can find, oh, Marcello's in there. Oh, okay, what else is in here? Now that I got Marcello, you understand what I'm saying? You just use the period and it just drives down further, okay? So I got the friends, I press period, Marcello's in there. Oh, what else is in here? Ooh, nobody reads. And this is what happens when you start programming in Revit. You're like, I just got that ramp. What else is in there? Period. Oh my goodness, look at all that stuff. Okay, so period. Oh, I got it. I got, he knows the Dynamo or not? I got his location. Oh my gosh, that's an idiot. But by the way, these were preset like program references that I made. But you didn't have to make a reference. Dynamo, Revit already made it for you. The Revit API, whatever. You use those references and it's got all the database stuff in there. Okay, so here we go. All right, so then you just, what you gotta do is, since this is already finding my age, you just gotta go and close it in parentheses. Okay, you got 5 minutes. Now, watch this. You're like, hey, that's fine and dandy, but no, it's not. You basically found out this Marcello's age object, okay? That's gonna give you the answer. But it's gonna stay within this program unless you kick it out. So you have to return it. You gotta get it out of the program. So all you do is you just say return. Okay, return, what do you wanna return? You can return anything you want. You can return flowers, you know, chairs, whatever you want. But no, I actually want to return Marcello's age object. And that's what I'm going to return. And that's what's going to become my output port. Bang, bang. Whoops, bang, bang. Okay? There you go. Now I'm going to compile. going on here? There you got it. That should be it. Okay, I'm going to build this. Come on. Build succeeded. Okay, ready? Watch this. I got to make sure I get over there. Copy. Okay, here we go. I've never done this live. I've never been coding live before. Oh, this is crazy. Okay, new. You load it into the import library. Find it. Here it is. Is this the right time? Open. There it is. I called it ETAB Simple. Remember, that was the book. That was the namespace. That was the class. And that right there is the name of our node, right? Isn't that the method we named it? Marcello's age node. And all we do is roll over this, and pow, we got a page. Unfortunately. All right. Pretty cool, right? You're like, you know what? There is actually no input port here. There's no input port. You want an input port? Yeah, I want an input port. Oh, my gosh. Okay. I was thinking for age, what can you do for input port? Oh, bad. I could take something for sure. Right? You got to type it in here now in between these if you want an input port. So I'm going to do int again. I'm going to say, I don't know, fudge factor. Like, you know, like you're talking, you're talking to someone and you're like, but see, you don't want to do that all the time. So you want to set a default of zero, right? So you only throw it out when you need it. Right? So you're like, okay, all right, and then you just put it here. You say here, I'm gonna say minus, minus, right? Because you don't say you're old, well, maybe you do. And then you say fudge, there. Oh, there it is, perfect. Okay, good, I'm gonna compile one more time. It's Dynamo close. Ready, build, solution. Succeeded? Okay, you gotta let me do this. I know if I run over 1 minute, don't kill me. Okay, here we go. Does anyone want to see this? All right, okay. All right, ready? New. Here we go. Input library. Okay, here we go. New timestamp. Okay, good. Here we go. All right, class. This is actually the name of your DLL. This is the name of your book, which is your namespace. This is the name of your class. This is the name of your method, which is your node. There we go. So I got Marcello at 43. But you know, depending where I'm at, you know, if I'm, I don't know if I'm, I mean, if I'm, you know, if I'm talking to millennials, maybe I'll do like this, you know, and then I'll put it in there. No, I don't. Maybe I'm talking to baby boomers, then I can go negative. You know, and I can go like that. Okay, how cool is that? Anyone want to go run home and code now? Yes. My good donkey. That's funny. You know, the elephant surprisingly definitely had a 15-minute frame. I got a lot of people come up on me and say, "Hey, well, you're all just like all that." I mean, sure, go to my blog site and put requests in. I'm always looking for animals and all. So there are a few we didn't get through. I just want to point them out really quick in the last second. There is a huge portion on analysis. If you're linking the structural analysis, so you could actually pull data out of that. There is some engineering logic that you need if you have to do structure, or if you want to have some logic in your laying something out, you know, an architecture, person with a comic. And then there's some things about like a lighting beam. But those are the only three like we missed. I think we did pretty good. Okay, thank you, everyone.
Thank you, Marcello.
Thank you so much for coming out. That is our community and I personally saw Revit art and Dynamo art or porn, I'm really not sure. But it was really good. It was awesome. What you showed us, I don't think all of us think of it and take home and use. So thank you all for coming out tonight. We have this recorded. It'll be posted at some point later date. And hopefully, if you all are nice to Marcello, we can invite him back to our music group event. Thanks for coming out. Right. Thank you.
I'll be back for a while. Hi, how are you? Yeah, that's one of them, yeah. Thanks, everyone, for having me.